worked for the New Yorker for 20 years, covering all sorts of wonderful topics, science, art. I know him mainly through his books. He wrote a beautiful book on Robert Irwin, beautiful book on David Hockney. The book that I first read of yours, though, was in 1996, was Mr. Wilson's Cabinet of Wonders. And so a few people have read that. I thought it was a novel. I first read that. And it's about...
It was a work of magic realist nonfiction.
It is. It's a beautiful book. It's about a very eccentric curator, and maybe we'll talk about him, David Wilson, who runs a museum called the Museum of Jurassic Technology, which is a beautiful book. Most recently, he wrote a biography of his longtime friend, Oliver Sacks, who I'm sure many of you know. Oliver Sacks' dad is my grandmother's physician, so we have a connection that way. And Ren is here partly because we're collaborating with SAIT, Santa Fe, a beautiful museum, and we gave a nice talk last night about Kate's exhibition. SAIT, if you haven't seen it, it's got 1 day left, 2 days left.
Sunday's the last Sunday.
It's called Metaphysics. If you've not seen it, you should go and see it. Very nice talk. And this is actually really nice to have this intimate relationship with another organization in town. And the new director, Lewis Ratchers, he's not here, but he's a very collaborative, very wonderful person. So with that, I hand it over to you, Ren.
Okay.
So to understand that Ren's going to talk about science and art. We talk a lot about understanding the limits of understanding and knowledge in relation to humans and machines. And I think maybe the aesthetic, artistic discussion is maybe the one that we're missing a little bit in that conversation. So hopefully you'll touch on that.
Okay. Thank you so much. The title of this is Art and Science as Parallel and Divergent Ways of Knowing. I don't ordinarily give my talks such clunky titles, but this was actually 11 years ago now. The National Science Foundation had a conference on that topic, and I gave the keynote talk, which was the embryo of this talk that just keeps every time I, after we when you do a conversation, you're going to give me great quotes, and I'll throw this, and just gets bigger and bigger. So parenthetically, it's going to run somewhat long, but then I'm happy to stay here as long as you want to talk about it afterwards. So perhaps to begin with, the remark of one of the foremost lepidopterists, we should say butterfly scientists, Russian butterfly scientist of the 20th century, who said that the true master blends the precision of the poet and the imagination of the scientist. His name was V.V. Nabokov, and he himself considered his great work in life was his butterfly work. I was telling David that Nabokov and I shared a publisher in Italy. That's as far as I will go with anything I have in common with Nabokov, but Roberto Colasso. And Roberto Colasso was visiting Montreux in Switzerland, where Nabokov was. And he said, just in passing, what do you think of Venice? And Nabokov said, I've never been to Venice. And he was drop-jawed. He just couldn't. Really? Okay. I'm not worried. Anyway, he was saying that he said, I've never been. He says, why ever not? And the answer came, no butterflies. Anyway, or we could talk about Ezra Pound. I don't have a slide of him, who liked to insist that poetry should be at least as well written as prose. And he used to advise young writers, quote, to accept the discipline imposed by Agassiz on his scientific protégés, who had to describe a dead fish over and over till they had it right as the fish was decomposing. Or for that matter, we could go to Cézanne, who said, you have to hurry if you're going to see everything is fast disappearing. To return to the subject of poets, though, I thought I would start. I often start my my talks with the morning, the afternoon, the noon prayer, I guess I'd call it, which is a poem. And in this case, I want to refer to Thomas Lynch. Do any of you know him? He's a remarkable poet. And he's, in fact, the undertaker poet. His day job is an undertaker. And then he goes home and writes these amazing poems. And he has a poem called Euclid, which I thought would be a good jumping off point. Euclid, like, you know, the mathematician. What sort of morning was Euclid having when he first considered parallel lines? Or that business about how things equal to the same thing are equal to each other? Who's to know what the day has in it? This morning, Bert took it out into his mind to make a longbow out of Osage orange and went on eBay to find the cow horns from which to fashion the tips of the thing. You better have something to pass the time, he says, stirring his coffee, smiling. And Murray is carving a model truck from a block of walnut he found downstairs. Whittling away, he thinks of the years he drove between Detroit and Buffalo delivering parts for General Motors. Might he have nursed theorems on lines and dots, or the properties of triangles, or the congruence of adjacent angles? Or clearing customs at Niagara Falls arrived at some insight on holes and parts, or an axiom involving radii and the making of circles, how distance from a center point can be both increased endlessly and endlessly split. A mystery whereby the local and the global share the same vexations and geometry. Possibly this is where God comes into it, who breathed the common notion of coincidence into the brain of that Alexandrian over breakfast 23 centuries ago, who glimpsed for a moment that morning the sense it all made. Life, killing time, the elements, the dots and lines and angles of connections, an egg's shell opened with a spoon, the sun's connivance with the moon's decline. Sophia, the maidservant, pouring juice. Everything, everything coinciding. The arc of memory, her fine parabolas, the bend of a bow, the curve of the earth, that turn in the road. Sophia, the maidservant, or Sophie the maidservant, or rather Sophia, the Hellenistic Alexandrian personification of wisdom. Although myself, I like to think that she was pouring milk, not orange juice. And for that matter, to think of Lynch himself having something quite like Vermeer's milkmaid in mind. Which in turn brings me to a marvelous poem. By the way, this is such an amazing, when you see the poem, next time you either see it in person or see a really good reproduction, the milk pouring is moving. It's absolutely amazing thing to see. It's actually, if you stare at it, somehow it's amazing. Anyway, but that brings me to another poem. We'll start with two poems today. This is by Wisława Szymborska, the great, great Polish poet. Very easy to find her in the bookstore. If you go to the poetry section, her name is spelled S-Z-Y-M-Borska, Szymborska. And so it's the last S poet on the shelf, probably. And she obviously won the Nobel Prize. When I used to be on the Rolodex for NPR whenever something happened in Poland, because I covered Poland for the New Yorker. And so she won that day and they had me on. And I said, you know how, you know, in the morning when they announce the Nobel Prize, it's always something you've never heard of, you know, and you feel like a doofus. And the only person who's ever heard of that person is Susan Sontag. And of course, Susan Sontag has read all of that person's book. And then you go and read them. And in fact, they're really lousy. They're really boring. And this is not going to be that case. This is going to be your favorite poet. And I will make that claim to any of you who've never read her before. And I'll start with this poem to give you a sense. Maybe all this, title of the poem, and she means all this. She means, you know, this room, Santa Fe, you know, the desert, the water crisis, the Ukraine, maybe all this. Maybe all this is happening in some lab. under one lamp by day and billions by night? Maybe we're experimental generations, poured from one vial to the next, shaken in test tubes, not scrutinized by eyes alone, each of us separately plucked up by tweezers in the end. Or maybe it's more like this, no interference. The changes occur on their own according to plan. The graph's needle slowly etches its predictable zigzags. Maybe thus far we haven't been of much interest. The control monitors aren't usually plugged in, only for wars, preferably large ones, for the odd ascent above our clump of Earth, for major migrations from point A to point B. Maybe just the opposite. They've got a taste for trivia up there. Look on the big screen, a little girl is sewing a button on her sleeve. The radar shrieks, the staff comes at a run. What a darling little bean with its tiny heart beating inside it. How sweet its solemn threading of the needle. Someone cries enraptured. Quick, get the boss, he's got to see this for himself. For surely the image Zimborska had in mind. Zimborska, who also wrote a poem called In Praise of Vermeer, and who said, in my dreams, I paint like Vermeer of Delft. Surely the image on the screen is this. We'll talk about this painting for a few minutes in our terms. One of the most remarkable things about this painting, and I doubt you'll be able to see it clearly, but again, go look up a really good reproduction, is the way that everything in the painting itself, not just this reproduction here, is slightly out of focus. Absolutely everything is, one thing is in crystal clear, crisp focus, and it's the V of threads going between those two tendril things and the point where she's putting her finger. That little V, the thing that she's concentrating on, is completely in focus. And this is out of focus and so forth. Indeed, the painting is all about concentration. Gradually, inspiringly, we come to concentrate on the very thing that the girl herself is concentrating on, everything else receding to the periphery of our awareness. Like nothing else so much as a painter, or in this context, we might say a scientist, lavishing his or her entire attention on their subject. Or perhaps what happens as we ourselves pause, dumbstruck before the canvas in the midst of our museum walk. I know you probably think I'm exaggerating, but look more closely at the threads themselves. They arrange themselves, as I say, into a crisp, tight V, couched in the M of the hands around. V, M. And in effect, godlike, she is looking down on V.M. Vermeer, the author of her being. The author, and hence back to the poem, for the girl threading the needle, the little darling being with its tiny heart inside, is of course none other than the poet herself, intent over her scribbled page, laboring toward the perfected line, or else subsequently perhaps us, her readers, hunched over the completed poem. Though as the creator of the poem, Zimborska is of course simultaneously the boss, as we too, the readers, get momentarily to be recreating, recapitulating her epiphanic insight, seeing it clearly for ourselves. Indeed, Zimborska gets it just right. Here in the perfected work of art, be it a poem or a painting, and I'm going to argue an experiment and its conclusion, across the endlessly extended split second of concentrated attention, artists and audience alike partake of a doubled awareness. The expansive vantage, lucidly equipoised of God, the concentrated experience, meltingly empathic of his or her most humble subject. So I want to begin, that was a long introduction, by talking about concentration, about absorption. The moment, as Leo Steinberg, the great art critic, says somewhere, when the artist stops asking, what can I do, and starts asking, what can art do? I imagine that's similar with scientists. What is the world doing? Or with Diderot, noting how painting is best when the artist steps back slack-jawed before his creation. Diderot, who also said that the artist is merely the first observer of the completed work, which is to say, that moment when the artist stops being the creator and suddenly becomes the slack-jawed witness. I can't remember what you said, but I was invited to, for 15 years to run the New York Institute for the Humanities at NYU. And when I took the job, I said that I would only take it if it was understood that, as far as I was concerned, the sciences are part of the humanities, not only part of the humanities, they are a crown jewel of the humanities. And as far as I'm concerned, that solves the question of artists versus scientists, of the humanities versus the sciences. That may require a new way of thinking about science, perhaps, from the perspective of its humanistic core. But of course, for starters, if you go back to the arts versus the sciences, that is a really recent development historically. That's maybe 200 or 300 years old. And I mean, if we go back further to the Age of Wonder, the 16th and 17th centuries, there was absolutely no distinction between artists and scientists. This is when you had, oh, by the way, I should have done that. I'm sorry. Yeah. Sorry. This is the Age of Wonder Cabinets. When Francis Bacon, he's one of the founders of science, you could say, but his prescription for the complete learned gentleman in 1594 was that, quote, such a gentleman should attempt to achieve within a small compass a model of the universal made private. Any such would-be magus would certainly want to compile, in Bacon's words, quote, a goodly huge cabinet, and it can either be a cabinet or cabinet as in room, a goodly huge cabinet, wherein whatsoever the hand of man by exquisite art or engine hath made rare in stuff, form, or motion, whatsoever singularity, chance, and the shuffle of things hath produced, the Shuffle of Things Institute. He's looking for a name for his institute. Whatsoever nature hath wrought in things that want life and may be kept, shall be sorted and included. And you'll notice in that particular list that it includes paintings. These are all things they are in those days talking about the wonder of creation as a celebration of the wonder of God, I suppose, but also that paintings are as amazing as scientific instruments. And if you look at this cabinet, they have shells, they have beetles, they have horns, they have scientific instruments, they have skulls with horns, lobsters, but they also have paintings. Every painting you've ever seen of Dürer, for example, began its life in a cabinet next to a pile of shells or corals or things like that. One could likewise go back further and talk about Leonardo and Michelangelo, who would never have understood and thought of themselves both and in the same breath and in the same activity as artists and scientists. In that case, it was really about anatomy, especially. Many of the great, great discoveries that begin to happen have to do in that period, have to do with artists secretly dissecting things and so forth. And generally, after that, anatomy lessons. Which brings me to this painting. I want to stop for a few moments to talk about, there's so many anatomy lesson paintings in the 1600s, but this is the one that comes down to us as the greatest. This is, of course, Rembrandt's anatomy lesson. Now let's look at this a little bit closely for a while. The year is 1632, which is to say the very middle of the 30 Years' War that is tearing Europe apart, with Protestants and Catholics and so forth. And it's a war that keeps on lurching into the Netherlands. It doesn't happen to be happening at that time. But, and this is the anatomy lesson of Professor Nicholas Turp, the most eminent anatomist in Amsterdam at the time. Rembrandt, by the way, who, I'll get to that. But Rembrandt, and I don't mean this Rembrandt, I mean this Rembrandt, is 26 years old. He has just arrived from Leiden, where there are many anatomy professors. Turp is the only one in Amsterdam. And he, in effect, is putting out his shingle with this painting. And the way you do a painting in the old days is you get subscriptions, who wants to be in the painting, and each of them pay some money up front and will pay later on, and they'll all be portrait, he'll do sessions with each of them and so forth. But he's putting on a shingle, and Tulip in turn is going to advertise his own brilliance as a and these things were, by the way, in this case, this is a lecture taking place in a public hall, much like this. And there was only one of these lectures in Amsterdam every year. And it happens in January, because it's when it's cold. So what have we got here? We've got a picture of a professor with a cadaver. The cadaver's arm is flayed. And he has his six students. By the way, I know you're going to say it's seven, but this guy here came late. He didn't turn in his money. And then after I don't know this for a fact, but looking at it, you can know for sure that Rembrandt had the whole thing mapped out in his head. And then this guy said, I want to be in. Why I want to be in? So he puts him in, but he's kind of a doofus, so just forget about it. Anyway, at a point here, importantly, is that the entire thing is a fiction. There was indeed a anatomical thing, but this is not a photograph. Rembrandt was in the audience taking sketches, and then he took sketches and then he put it together. And anybody who knew this would know how to read it, would know how to say, oh yeah, this guy's a doofus, he doesn't belong. You know, looking at the whole structure, it was kind of like a movie coming out. What does he mean when he puts that person there? What does he mean when he puts that person there? This is not random. Everything is thought out, and that's important to understand. And it's kind of difficult for us to look at all paintings that way, but we're so entrammeled in the world of the photographic, you know, the snapshot, but these are not snapshots. Anyway, there are all sorts of things we could say about the cadaver. By the way, we know his name. That's another lecture. But he was a thief. We know that. And he had been executed the day before. He'd been hung. He had stolen a cloak of a gentleman's, exactly the same kind of cloak that Nicholas Tulp is wearing. And that's why he was killed. He's naked except for a sheet covering his midriff, which recalls and no doubt intentionally alludes to this Mantegna. It's worth remembering that Christ, after all, himself was crucified between two thieves. But the point is, it's calling on that. It's recalling that. It's interesting, by the way, also that, let's see, it starts with the flayed hand, but that's not how they always started. This is a fiction that it's working from the flayed hand. You always started with the belly because that was the area that was going to rot the fastest. And all the other pictures of these things are... the paintings start with the belly. So the question is, why the flayed hand? And the reason is that Vesalius, who several generations earlier had been the greatest anatomist, had written the human fabric, the fabrica corpora, the corpora humani fabrica. And he had had, the whole thing had been illustrated by this great artist named Kalkar in etchings. And this was the cover illustration, the frontispiece, was that Vesalius flaying an arm. And so one possibility is that Toop asked to be portrayed doing the arm as a kind of, I am the new Vesalius, or conversely, Rembrandt did it to say, I am the new Kalkar. In any case, there's all sorts of themes going on in that. Well, I want to focus on something else for a moment, more precisely to have you focus on something else, because I want to try an experiment. Everybody should close their eyes right now. I'm serious. Close your eyes. You have it. And I want to ask you, in the picture, there are two groups of three students, three of them, the outer group and the inner group. The inner group are staring at something completely dumbfounded. They cannot believe what they're seeing. And the question is, what are they staring at? And if you're like me, I think you would think that they're staring amazed at the flayed arm. But if you look at the painting, I'm talking about this inner group of three here. They are staring at the professor's hand. The professor is saying, look, with this set of muscles here, you can do this. You can do this. And look at the look on their face. By the way, there is one train of thought. Well, first, let me just talk about this guy here. If you put your thumb in front of one eye, he's looking down. If you put your thumb in front of the other eye, he's looking at the hand. He's actually, this guy here, look at that. That one is looking at that, and the other one is looking at the hand. This is a movie. And he's just following what the professor is pointing to. Which is to say that this is a painting, not about death, but about life. And specifically about two things, about manipulability, manipulable hand, about the actions of the hand, and vision. It's about looking at the hand. It's about looking at the two things that are essential that make up the act of painting. So that in effect, you can think of it like this. You can think of it like this. The point is that it's not about death, as I was saying. And if you look at the onlookers with that in mind, what they suddenly seem to be doing is getting it. Oh, I see. I don't have my thing to ask. So I have to go back here. There. That great, that is the thing that I think that artists and scientists have in common. Oh, I see, I get it. That's what the scientist says when he or she finally figures something out. I see the veils, we say, are falling from their eyes. They are vouched a fresh perspective. Although it's worth noting here how Isaac Asimov further refines our understanding of the process by noting how, quote, the most exciting phrase to hear in science, the one that heralds a new discovery, is not eureka, but rather, huh, that's funny. And in a similar voice, a painter will say, why not this way? That's the moment, the great moment. What scientists are striving after is what artists are doing all the time. David Bohm, the physicist, said, physics is a form of insight and hence a form of art. Einstein always claimed that imagination was more important than knowledge for scientists. But Mark Twain had earlier noted how you can't depend on your eyes if your imagination is out of focus. One last thing about that flayed arm. That's what's happened to me is I don't have, this used to be on presenter view so I could see what was coming. I can't see what's coming anymore, but I'm going to do that there. There's no doubt that that flayed arm is Rembrandt referencing Michelangelo and the creation of man. It's a conspicuous illusion, which reminds me in turn of something that some of you may know. Have you ever noticed, or maybe it's been pointed out to you, or maybe you figured out for yourself, that God is enswathed in a whole swirl of fabrics and so forth that conspicuously look like the brain? And what's interesting here is that Rembrandt is following this aspect too in his painting. Notice, and it's a little bit hard, but if you get rid of the doofus, the collided area is like a skull. The eye sockets would be the professor's face. The jaw is the body. You know what I mean? This, by the way, also lets you should point out that there are many people, art historians say that what those guys are looking at is not the hand, but they're looking at the book, which is apparently Vesalius, by the way. And this is a thing about how important tradition is. This is nonsense. It's the kind of thing that people who write books would say. It is not what they're looking at. You can see, and there's some way, and think about this in terms of the brilliance of the right. You can see that they're looking at the hand and not at the book. When you go, especially when you're in person there. In it's in the Mauritius. Having said all that, I want to return to the notion that this is something that took place in public theaters, and it was fairly unusual for it to take place in Amsterdam. It happened once a year, in this case, January 16th, 1632. And it's almost certain that there was in the room, let me see where, yeah, there you can maybe see that a little bit better, but there was in the room all sorts of people, and W.G. Sebald in his Rings of Saturn surmises, and I'm pretty sure he's right, that one person who was, oh, by the way, that's the thing that the other three people are looking out at. So if I go back to that, so these three people are looking at the hand. These three people in the fictional apparatus of the painting are looking at the painter. They're looking out into the audience. You know, and you can imagine the painter. And they're looking equally stunned, by the way, at the painter. They are as amazed as the others. So that's a little thing I gave you a sense of what might have, in that this is, by the way, not what was actually happening, because as I said, there was nobody painting while the thing was going on, but that's what the fiction of the painting is, that this was happening. And there was a whole audience. And Sebald is absolutely convinced and completely convincing that there was somebody in the room that day who was crucial to our story. That there was a emigre because of the wars of religion, an anatomy besotted emigre named Descartes. He was completely into anatomy at this point. There's no doubt he was in. We know he was in Amsterdam that day. He would have been there. And that becomes extremely important in our story, because that in turn means that this is a painting of the day it happens. The day the delamination of humanities and sciences begins to happen. Within a couple of years of this, Descartes is going to be writing his discourse on method and his geometry. And a couple of years after that, he's going to be writing his meditations on first philosophy. And he will be creating, in effect, this mind-body split, the humanity. And he's going to talk about, what if these are, everybody you see are robots? And at one point he has this side, and this is, I regard the body as a machine so built, put together of bone, nerve, muscle, vein, blood, and skin, that still, although it had no mind, it would not fail to move in all the same ways as at present, since it does not move by direction of its will or mind, but only by arrangement of its organs. This is also, by the way, if you think about it, near the origin, right at the same time, of Cartesian geometry, which is the geometry of the cruciform of the X and Y axis, and all the kinds of quantifiable things that become possible through looking at the world that way, but also the delamination that begins to take place in terms of art and science. Oliver Sacks, my friend, once discussing this moment, I mean, that moment that we were talking about, in a lecture he gave with the interesting title of The Neurology of the Soul, said, the Cartesian notion of man as a machine is tremendously powerful and indeed was absolutely necessary for the rise of an empirical objective science. But it is not enough. It cannot tell us about the personal, the I inside the physiological. A purely physiological explanation offends common sense and one's own egotism. Mechanistic neurology needs to be complemented by an existential neurology of fate, internal landscape, face, individual. When we used to go out on to the Little Sisters hospitals where he was doing a lot of his work in these poor houses, he would say to me that he was a clinical ontologist, by which, so of course, you know, ethics is this philosophy of right behavior, and aesthetics is the philosophy of beauty, and epistemology is the philosophy of knowledge versus belief or whatever. Ontology is the philosophy of being itself. And he said, I'm a clinical ontologist. I am someone for whom the diagnostic question is, how are you? How do you be? What is it like to be you? I titled the book I wrote about him, and how are you, Dr. Sacks? Anyway, he goes on, until we achieve such a conjunction, the existential neurology, we can never hope to fathom the mysteries of perception and action, but will remain lost in the empty labyrinths of empiricism. We need, if it's not a contradiction in terms, a science of the individual, or at very least one that does not do violence to the individual. All of which, I wasn't going to include this, I was going to make it a little bit longer, but I'm going to do it because I'm doing this for you. I told him he should call his institute the Nicholas of Cusa Society. That's all that stuff. So this is Nicholas of Cusa, one of my all-time favorite metaphors for the situation was provided by Nicholas of Cusa, 1401 to 64, who was a late medieval jurist, astronomer, diplomat, Archbishop of Cologne, and a mathematician, and in that final capacity, something of a mystic. He, by the way, knew that the Earth went around the sun. He knew that he had figured out the diameter of the Earth, all this before Copernicus was published. In any case, his great masterpiece, which you should look for, is called Learned Ignorance. And basically the deal with Cusa is that he was involved in a generational debate with the follower of the followers of Thomas Aquinas from the previous century, and about how you could get to knowledge of the whole of God. In a sense, putting Thomas Aquinas is an Aristotelian, which is to say that he says that if you want to know about the creator, you just study creation. You do a book about all the fishes of the world. You do a book about all the ethics of the world. You do a book about all the stars. You do a book about all the optics. And you know, once you've done everything, you're eventually going to get to an amazement, a prayer-filled amazement of God. And Cusa, who was a Neoplatonist without knowing it, says, that can't be right. He says, think of a circle. And the argument goes like this. Think of a circle with an n-sided regular triangle inside. It's a regular polygon inside. So it starts as a triangle, you add a sinus, a square, a regular pentagon, and it keeps on adding. He says, eventually you're going to have a million sides. So you think you're getting really, really close to the circle. He's, by the way, saying all this before the invention of calculus too. He said, but in fact, you're not. The thing you have created has a million sides. The circle only has one side. The thing you've created has a million angles. The thing that you're trying to achieve has no angles. He said, at some point, you have to make the leap from the chord to the arc, which he calls the leap of faith. That is where Kierkegaard got the phrase. And he said, which can only be accomplished in grace. I would argue it's certainly the case with me, and I think with many poets, and I suspect it's the case with scientists, that you work and you work and you work at something that then happens by itself. It would not have happened without all that prior work, which is kind of preparation for receptivity, but that something else happens that personally, unaccountably fits together. And I think that is I'd be curious whether you agree that that is a kind of thing that artists have all the time, but anyway, I wanted to float some of these notions before going on to talk for most of the rest of this talk about two artists in particular who I've spent a lot of time with. These are Robert Irwin and David Hockney. Later on, if during the question session, if anybody wants to say, I can tell you the story how I ended up being ensorcelled into both of their worlds. They can't stand each other. The quick version is that I had written this book about Robert Irwin that was ran in the New Yorker, when I first encountered Irwin, anybody would have said he was one of the top 10 artists in the country, any artist, but the layman, nobody had ever heard of him, you know, because he never did things that lasted or were around, or he wouldn't allow photography of his work. And so I did this thing and it ran in the New Yorker, and I get a phone call from David Hockney, who I had heard of. And he says, I've been reading your book and I disagree with every single thing in it, but I can't stop thinking about it. Why don't you come by and we'll talk about it? So the next time I was in LA, I was now in New York. I went to his studio, and that was the moment when he was doing those Polaroid collages. And as he was talking, he says, we're going to be doing a big book. Why don't you write the essay for that? And so eventually I did. And that essay, when you read it, is in fact a point by point refutation of Irwin. And then Irwin read it and called me and said, what a bunch of bullshit. It happens that I have a show opening at the Museum of Contemporary Art. Why don't you write the essay for that? And so I wrote the essay for that. And that was his refutation of Hockney. And then Hockney had a show at the Met, and I did the essay for that. And that was his. And this has been going on for 35 years. They have never met each other, but they're always kind of in touch with each other. And by the way, it's not a personal fight. It is a fight about, both of them believe that the single most important thing in the 20th century, bar none, was Cubism, if you understand Cubism correctly. And they both believe that if you understand it correctly, you'd be doing what they're doing, not what the other one is doing. And so I can talk about that more. But at this point, I just want to talk about how both of them, as it happens, while I was working with them, began to get very involved with scientists. So I'll start with Irwin. I have a chapter in the book called Art and Science, actually. And Irwin didn't really think much about scientists until 1969, when he was in the first art and technology show in LA. And he was put together with an aerospace company, in particular with a guy named Ed Wertz, who was figuring out habitability in spacecraft in outer space and lack of gravity. And there's a wonderful photograph of them, what the day that it begins, of their collaboration. And Irwin has long hair down to his shoulders, and Edwards has a crew cut, and he has a short sleeve white shirt, and he has the plastic Piper clip. You know, he's just totally that thing. Within 1 year, Bob had cut his hair short, and Edwards had quit and become a union psychotherapist, with long hair, and they remained dear friends, but they talked to each other a lot about what the difference was. And so Irwin, talking to me now, says that artists and scientists have a lot in common and certain differences. He says, take a chemist, he says. He starts out with a hypothesis about what might be created if he combined a few chemicals, and he begins by simply doing trial and error. 2/3 of this, 1/3 of that, and he marks down the result. He tries 1/3 of this and 1/3 of that, 1/3 of the third thing, and he marks down the result. He goes on and so forth. What the artist does is essentially, it's also sort of a yes-no trial and error process. He says what the artist does is essentially the same. In other words, what you do when you start to do a painting is that you begin with a basic idea, a hypothesis, of what it is you're trying to go for. Maybe it's the model over there with the trees outside and the oranges on the table. And from there on, it's just a million yes-no decisions. Look again, the work is not working. No, you sort of erase it out, you move it on. The only difference is the character of the product. Let's say at a particular point, the scientist gets what he has set out to get. He arrives at what he projected would happen. But the same thing is true of the artist. When he finally gets to the right combination, he stops. He knows he's finished. The thing is, once you ask the artist, scientist is finished, you can look back over his notes to consider the precise sequence of yes-no weighings that brought him to that solution. It's all quite logical and structured. The artist, on the other hand, keeps no such record, although historians would love it if he did. Rather, he literally paints over his errors. And 6 months later, when you ask him, why did you stop there? He gives you the preposterous answer, because it felt right. Which drives, scientists of art crazy. What do you mean it felt right? The critical difference is the artist measures from his intuition. One of the things he's talking about here, by the way, is he's talking about the difference between logic and reason. When I first started hearing him talk, I thought they were the same thing. He says, no, the thing is, scientists use logic and artists use reason. You can use logic, you can't logic, you reason. And reason uses your own sensorium, your own sense of feel. It feels right, categories like that. There's a chapter in the book which is completely hilarious of him. For a long time, Bob Irwin made his life playing the horses. He would start in January 1st, and he would go to the racetracks, and he'd go every day until he'd made whatever it was he could need, $40,000 he'd need for the year, and then he stopped. And he has a description in the book of what it's like to make a bet. And he starts out with all the logical stuff, all the forms, what the different fractions of the race were and so forth, and earlier races. He figures all that stuff out. And then afterwards, he says, I take my hand across the race to get a feel of what's going to happen. And then, and only then he places his wager. Later on, he starts doing site-specific works, where he'll go and, do maps, look at the surveys, he'll figure out the heights and everything, and then he will take his hand over the whole situation and he'll place his wager, the gesture, this is what needs to be done. Anyway, so he goes on talking about that sort of thing, and he talks about how logic is an external thing, clock time, different weights, all the kinds of measurements and so forth, all the things you can do on Cartesian geometry. He says, reasoning appears to be more confused, more haphazard, partly because it's being done by feel, by touch in some sense, but partly because of the scale of what is being dealt with. The logical, in a sense, seems more successful because it cuts the scale down. In fact, that's what makes it logical. It takes a very concise cut in the world. We're back with Descartes here. Arms revealed. And it simply defines or redefines by deduction the properties of that cut. But it never deals with the overall complexities of the situation. It only applies within the confines in which it operates. So it seems much clearer. In this context, I was talking with Jaron Lanier recently, a great digital kind of the inventor of virtual reality in some ways and so forth. although he said he did it. And he was saying, information systems need to have information in order to run, but information underrepresents reality. What makes something fully real is that it is impossible to fully represent it to completion, to represent it to completion. Went on to elaborate, a digital image of a painting is forever a representation, not a real thing. A real painting is a bottomless mystery, like any other real thing. A representation is not. Such that, again, we're back with Nicholas of Cusa. Digitally, you can do the million-sided polygon, but you can't get something yourself. Or with Eudora Welty, the great short story writer, who says, making reality real is art's responsibility. The artist, however, and now I'm back with Irwin, as a reasoning being, attempts to deal with the overall complexity of which all logical subsystems are merely segments. He deals with them through the intuitive side of his potential, human potential, and here inconsistencies are as meaningful as consistencies. I have other things, but I want to move on to Hockney. And at a certain point, after he had been working for a while on the various collages and so forth, he kind of went through a phase. He always had different phases. He had a phase where he was working on Chinese paintings. He had a phase when he was, and so forth. And he had the Polaroids for a long time. And then he had a phase where he got fascinated by physics. And he says this, that, let's see, I was browsing through some books about physics at a friend's house. And in one of them, there were two or three sentences that got me going. Coming back, I picked up several other books, and to my amazement, I found incredible connections with the sorts of things I was concerned about. For instance, in the old Newtonian view of the world, Newtonian physics, or as I might call them in this present context, Cartesian physics, it says, if the world exists outside of us, it's over there, out there, it works mechanically, and it will do so with or without us. In short, we're really not part of nature. It virtually comes down to that. Whereas modern physics has increasingly thrown that model into question and shown how it cannot be. Mr. Einstein makes things more human by making measurement at least relevant relative to us, or anyway to some observer. The supposedly neutral viewpoint is obliterated. He goes on to talk about, he got very into David Bohm and wholeness in the implicate order. You can see, he gives me some quotes tonight, you can see why I was so excited. This insistence on the need to break down borders to entertain the interconnectedness of things and of ourselves with things. The notion that in science today, it is no longer possible to have ideas about reality without taking our consciousness into account. And beyond that, just the language that Bohm shares with the other physicists. They're always talking about overall worldview, the need for new horizons, wider perspectives, or a new picture of reality. All these are visual metaphors. There's that famous phrase of Gombrich's about the triumph of Renaissance perspective. We have conquered reality. A phrase that has always seemed to me such a Pyrrhic victory, as if it really were somehow separate from us and would now be hopelessly dull because everything we now was now known and accounted for. And he goes on from there. But now going quickly back to Irwin, who says that at the periphery of any body of knowledge he came to feel, because he began going to a lot of conferences like this, and he would say at the periphery of any body of knowledge and every body of knowledge, there are laborers who are working beyond the sovereignty of the techniques of their disciplines. They are all guided principally by their reason, not by logic. There are laborers who are working beyond, and he calls this thing the dialogue of immanence. And he says what's fascinating, what he has found fascinating, is that they keep on bumping into each other. The people who are doing at the edge of architecture are bumping into people at the edge of physics. Scientists like him, painters like him, are having very interesting conversations with people on the edge of biology and so forth. Another word that he uses to talk about the dialogue of immanence is inquiry. All these researchers are engaged in their own way in the process of inquiry. And the most salient feature of inquiry is its open-endedness. It is pursued for no reason whatsoever. It is the project of the passionately curious. The wilderness is stalked by explorers without maps and without any particular goals, and their principal compass is their reason. This reminds me of a thing I skipped over, which I can find quickly. I'll redo this. This is a great line of Elizabeth Bishop, the poet. I recently read how Elizabeth Bishop told her first biographer, Anne Stevenson, that, quote, she admired the beautiful, solid case being built out of Darwin's heroic observations, unquote, and went on to say that what one seems to want in art and experiencing it is the same thing necessary for its creation, which she calls a self-forgetful, perfectly useless concentration. Okay, so now I'm rounding them in and we're coming to the end. Freeman Dyson, writing in the New York Review of Books, at one point argued, the public has a distorted view of science because children are taught in school falsely that science is a collection of firmly established truths, whereas in fact, science is not a collection of truths. It is a continuing exploration of mysteries. Coming around from the other side, James Baldwin, and this is my nomination for being the James Baldwin Institute. James Baldwin said, the purpose of art is to lay bare the questions which have been occluded by the answers. Isn't that a great line? The purpose of art is to lay bare the questions that have been occluded, hidden by the answers. In closing, I'd like I'm going to do two last poems, in effect, now that we're at the end. One of them is a prose poem, and it comes from my old colleague at the New Yorker, Ian Fraser, known as Sandy, and to my mind is the greatest nonfiction writer of my generation. Incredible character. I was once on a panel with him, with some high school students at the Museo del Barrio, and one of them asked, What's your favorite novel that you read recently? And Sandy said, I don't read novels. And I looked at him, what do you mean you don't read novels? He said, you know, it's always, it begins, there once was a man. And I just say, no, there wasn't. But anyway, having said that, he is the most novelistic of nonfiction writers. And he has a great, great piece about bears. This is the idea that you can do anything with. And he just had been keeping a file of clippings. In those days, we had clippings. We cut them out and put them in a file and of bear human contacts. And he just took out the file, put it on his desk, and he wrote this wonderful piece about bears based on it. And it came to the last paragraph goes like this. It's possible to walk for a long time through the woods and not see much of anything. Beautiful scenery makes it its point quickly. Then you have to pay attention or it starts to slide by like a looped background in a Saturday morning cartoon. A pine cone falls from one limb to another. A rock platters down a canyon and your own thoughts talk on inside your head. People sometimes say that what is great about bears, and especially grizzlies, is the large tracts of wilderness that they imply. That a good bear population implies a healthy, unspoiled habitat. But bears don't simply imply wilderness. Bears are wilderness. Bears are what all the trees and rocks and meadows and mountains and drainages must add up to. When you see a bear, the spot where you see it becomes instantly different from every other place you've seen. Bears make you pay attention. They keep the mountains from turning into a blur and they stop yourself from bullying you like nothing else in nature. A woods with a bear in it is real to a man walking through it in a way that a woods with no bear is not. Roscoe Black, that name for the story, this is a newspaper name, Roscoe Black, a man who survived a grizzly attack in Glacier Park several years ago, described the moment when the bear had him on the ground. He He laid on me for a few seconds, not doing anything. I could feel his heart beating against my heart. Now, this is Sandy. The idea of that heart beating someplace just the other side of ours is what makes people read about bears, tell stories about bears, argue about bears, and theorize about bears, and be drawn and dream about bears. Bears are one of the places in the world where the big mysteries run close to the surface. And now, just to end with a final poem. And in this case, our poet is Thomas Tranströmer. I read from this poem yesterday, but I'll now read the whole poem. Thomas Tranströmer, I used to always tell people that the great tragedy of his life was that he was Swedish, and so he would never win the Nobel Prize. And then he won the Nobel Prize. So, go figure. But he has a wonderful poem called Sentry Duty or Guard Duty. And it is a fact that in Sweden, everybody has to do a year's all men have to do a year's compulsory military service, which is kind of ridiculous. What are they doing it for? But in his case, he at one point was put on the Norwegian border to make sure that no Norwegians were invading. And it was the middle of the night, and he writes this poem. It's translated by Robert Bly, by the way. I'm ordered out to a big hump of stones as if I were an aristocratic corpse from the Iron Age. The rest of them are still back in this tent, sleeping, stretched out like spokes in a wheel. In the tent, the stove is boss. It's a big snake that swallows a ball of fire and it hisses. But it's silent out here in the spring night among chill stones, waiting for the dawn. Out here in the cold, I start to fly like a shaman, straight back to her body. Some places pale from her swimming suit. The sun shone right on us. The moss was hot. I brush along the side of warm moments, but I can't stay there long. I'm whistled back through space. I crawl among the stones, back to here and now. Task to be where I am. Even in this solemn and absurd role, I am still the place where creation does a little work on itself. Task to be where I am. Even in this solemn and absurd role, I am still the place where creation does a little work on itself. Dawn comes, the spare tree trunks take on color now, the frostbitten work. Forest flowers from a silent search party after something that has disappeared in the dark. But to be where I am and to wait. I'm full of anxiety, obstinate, confused. Things not yet happened are already here. I feel that they're just out there, a murmuring mass outside the barrier. They can only slip in one by one. They want to slip in. Why? They do one by one. I am the turnstile. To be the turnstile and to wait. To be the place where creation does a little work on itself. One could hardly do better by way of characterization of the scientist's lot and the artists only attend. Thank you. By the way, I made copies of the poems and things. So anyway, so I've run over. What is the etiquette now? Can I take questions or whatever?
Yes.
If you have to go, I understand. It's my fault. I went too long. But if you can stay, I'd love to talk. Yeah.
What was the name of the, I believe, 14th century?
Nicholas of Cusa, C-U-S-A. Nicholas of Cusa.
Thank you.
And it's variously spelled Nicolas of Cusa, with a C-H-C-O. Always Cusa, C-U-S-A. Learned Ignorance is his book.
So then what's the fundamental disagreement between Erwin and Hockney?
Well, as I said, they both, and by the way, it's funny because when I published my book, the new edition of Seeing is Forgetting, which is the blue edition, on the same day I published the green edition of all the Hockney essays I'd done. And so they argue it out between themselves on the bookshelf. And when I gave a talk at Marfa, Texas, about the argument between them, they had a hilarious poster, which was like a Mexican wrestler's. It was Lawrence Weschler on Robert Irwin, David Hockney, and so forth. And Marfa is a very Robert Irwin town. And so and they were not going to listen to David Hockney, but actually, I think the argument itself is very interesting. So the basic argument is that they both feel that if you take cubism seriously, it's the most important thing. Irwin has this great passage in the book where he talks about the fact of what was the subject of art over the last 500 years, that it begins with Christ on the cross, and then eventually there's the monks praying underneath, and at a certain point you begin to have the burgher who commissioned the painting, and then further down the line you get the burgher's maid, and then you get a red shawl, and then you get the red shawl, and then so on and so on. And then he says, and what's happening is the progressive flattening of what the subject of art is. And so until it's you know, just the red shawl, the color red, and so forth. And he says, if you follow that seriously, and my book about him is called Seeing is Forgetting, the name of the thing one sees, because what's fascinating reading about him, or reading him talking about his past, is that he systematically got rid of all the things that you would think you would need in a painting. Figure. And then he, for a while, was doing paintings of just lines, like pickup sticks. And then people said, oh, those are like pickup sticks. And he wanted to figure out how he could do a painting that people wouldn't say it was of something, but it just was itself. So then he just did two lines. These are amazing paintings, by the way. He spent he was working 16 hours a day for 3 years, painting two lines on a canvas. And then lowering the line, making it a little bit longer, making one a little bit longer, a little bit shorter, 16 hours a day. At the end, he merged with 10 paintings. And they're fascinating paintings because you go to a museum and you look at them, you can't look at both lines. If you see one, as people kept saying, oh, those paintings have two lines, but you never see both lines. If you look at one, the other disappears. If you look at that one, this one disappears. And if you try to look at both of them, there's this kind of field of energy in the middle. But people kept on saying those are paintings of lines. And one of the problems that he had was that he was trying to get this equivalence going, but there was the shadow behind the painting. And how could you look at the painting and not include the shadow? Everywhere he showed, he did repaint, he made the space absolutely pure, you know, painted it over many times, and then at a certain point, by the way, he had to get rid of the lines. So what he did is he did a series of paintings that where he had a bowed canvas and he painted it white, and then he put a series of thousands of dots in opposite colors, green and red, whatever, but very tiny, very faint. And these are exactly the paintings you go to the museum and somebody says, oh, fuck, this is what I hate about modern art, because they don't see anything. But if you stand, and I've sat in the corner and watched this, if you stand for 30 seconds looking at that white canvas, suddenly the thing blushes and you blush back. I've seen people blush red, where it just becomes this hive of incredible energy, but it has the shadows, and so that's a problem. So then he started paintings the color of shadow and discs that came out, and each thing he's trying to eventually and then he began doing prism columns that you couldn't see if you looked at them. But if you looked away, you saw them in the corner of your eye, but if you looked back, you couldn't see them again, and so forth. And he was trying, and then eventually he got to the point where he just didn't want to make objects at all. And he certainly didn't want to sign them, you know. At one point at the Venice Biennale, he's invited to be one of the artists in the American Pavilion, and he put some string around a patch of lawn and the shadows and so forth. As far as he's concerned, that's all that you need for art. And that the true subject of art is perception itself, is perceiving yourself perceiving. and he gets the point zero where he's doing nothing. Then he pops out the other side, and pretty soon he's the guy who's commissioned by the Getty to do the garden. It's the biggest public art commission of all time and so forth. But in any case, so he is feeling that. So for example, Hilton Kramer says, this is the law. This is the most nihilistic career there's ever been. We've lost everything. And he says, no, he says, the point of cubism is eventually to get to the marriage of figure and ground, by which he says, what would it mean if there was no figure in the painting apart from the ground? But the point being, what would it be like if you looked at everything with the intensity that you look at the figure of something ordinarily in a painting? And that was the point. And it was to get to pure empty space, and he would do things in the world and so forth that you couldn't tell what they were and so forth. So that's his argument, that the whole progression of art history is to get to more and more forgetting, and finally seeing is forgetting the name of the thing one sees, which is actually a line from Valéry, but the last thing you forget is even the name. To really, and this is visceral, to really look at that cup, to really see that cup, would be to forget what it's for and so forth. We were talking about Husserl at lunch, and Sartre tells the story how in 1933, he was at a cocktail party, and Raymond Aron had just returned from Berlin, or from Freiburg, where he had been studying with Husserl. And he says to Sartre, Husserl can take that apricot brandy in your hand and turn it into philosophy. And Sartre was on the next train. So in any case, that's what he believes. And very early on in the text that I did for the Polaroid book, without mentioning Irwin, Hockney says, you know, the whole point of art is figuration. We've been making figures for thousands and thousands, 30,000 years ago, we were making figures. All of art is about the history of figuration. I'm sure that one day in 1909, 1910, Braque and Picasso were talking to each other, and they said, you know, if you took one route from here, you could get more and more abstract, and then you'd end up in an empty room. But they didn't have to do it to know that that's not what they meant. That is, and another way of putting it, as far as Hockney is concerned, there's a huge crisis in the history of art in 1838 when photography is invented. And in fact, in 1838, photography is introduced as the end of painting. You don't need painters anymore because, look, we can do it. And suddenly, painting delaminates from portraying the real world, and you get to have all the isms, impressionism, expressionism, all the things that paint that a photograph can't capture. I should say, by the way, I'm going to stop at that moment and go back to the beginning. The first thing that Hockney said to me when I went to see him is he said, I used to think that Irwin was such a fetishist with this thing of his about not allowing photographs of his work. Typically, as you can imagine, Irwin would not allow a photograph of his work because he said a photograph would capture everything the work is not about and nothing that it is about. It would capture the image, but not the presence. So he wouldn't allow it. So somebody like me in 1975 had never seen any of his work because it had never been photographed. And Hockney says to me, I used to like think he was such a, but you know what? He was right. I wish, says Hockney, who has had his work photographed more than anyone else except for maybe Warhol, I guess. He says, I wish that I had never allowed any of my work to be photographed, because now nobody can come upon one of my paintings in a museum and not think of his dentist's office. And so in other words, what's to me fascinating about the two of them, when you read the two books side by side, they have so much in common. They're so Hockney says that the great crisis is 1838, and that cubism is the culmination of all the isms when you collapse a figure into ground, but you keep the figure. You don't give up the figure. That's the most important thing. It's finding a way to have a figure that yet is true to the complexity of the world. And when they talk about complexity, you know, there wouldn't be nuclear war, there wouldn't be a global climate change, climate crisis, if people were all cubists and had a sense of all how everything is related to everything and so forth. One day I was giving a lecture. This is actually a funny story. Three months earlier, I had my institute office. Some curators from Boston Museum of Fine Arts came and interviewed me about Hockney, because they were going to be doing a Hockney portrait show. And three years later, I get a phone call and the show's going to open, and would I come and be the keynote speaker? So I come and I'm in the hall and I get a call from Irwin. We talk probably each other once a month or so. And I get a call from Irwin. I said, you won't believe it. Where I am right now, I'm about to give a talk about David's portraits. And he says, you have me all wrong about David. I think he's a first-rate practitioner. And anyway, this, and what really got crazy at a certain point, people always say, well, why don't you introduce them to each other? And they are matter and antimatter. And you will know that they've met if the world just ceases to exist. But one day, they suddenly started having the same dealer pace. It was now both Hockney's and Irwin. And I was talking to Irwin on the phone, and he was at the thing. And then a Hockney called me, and he was walking toward pace. I said, oh, no. But luckily, they didn't see each other. I think there's a person at pace whose job is to make sure that never happens.
First of all, I have to say that I very, very much applaud your transformer and Jaborska here.
Well, can you? I just can't hear you say.
Yeah. I very much applaud you having Jaborska and transformer your poets, though I think that these are not the best translation.
There's great controversy about that. But yeah.
Of course, there would be. Yeah. But I've got a question actually about some two issues that you kind of pointed to but didn't go there. Mm-hmm. Thoughts are, because you obviously were time constrained.
One of them was what?
One of them would be, especially following on from Robert Irwin, it's very, very much pointing to the Eastern approaches to many of these issues, in particular painting and so on and so forth. There's the word is not being spoken, but nonetheless, there's a lot of feel of things like Buddhism of various sorts, Chinese landscape painting, of course, as far as Cubism. It had a lot of its origins in Hiroshige, Hakusai, and so on.
Sure.
But the other thing I would...
Which is to say, by the way, places where perspective didn't happen.
And figure ground. And
so in other words, places specifically where one-point perspective, the Renaissance perspective, didn't happen in Japan, didn't happen in China. And David Hockney, for instance, has fantastic stuff. He goes into a whole Chinese art thing because of this. This is a kind of depicting the world without perspective.
You got these beautiful photographs of the inside of temples. Mm-hmm. It was in that collage, which was, of course, very Cubist. But here's my other question. First, I want to ask how you see that as entering into your overall perception of the relationship between the arts and the sciences. But the other one, one could almost make the case that it's not the arts and the sciences that are actually soulmates, but the arts and math, especially where math of the 20th century got to what's in some senses, I would argue, is the most profound philosophy that we have ever had, coming up with impossibility theorems and things like this. In some ways, I would also say that's the most beautiful, the most silencing creations of humanity. And I'm wondering if you just didn't have time to math, or you see that?
Well, I just passed over what I said, the dialogue of immanence. Mathematicians are very much part of that. The people at the edges. So both of talking about the Oriental stuff first, it's not coincidental that a lot of this stuff is happening in California, and you are getting Asian wafts coming from California in a way that, for example, you're not getting European art coming to California. John McLaughlin is a person who was very important to Irwin and who had spent time in Japan. By the way, one of the things that happens in California is you have all these people who were in the occupying forces in Japan and then come back and so forth. Bob in particular has a story that he tells of how an incredible impact he had there was a hipster beatnik guy who would have him over to do a Japanese tea ceremony. And he described how first they would cook, and they would just, the dinner was just opening a can of beans, you know, chili beans and stuff like that, and putting the can itself on the fire, and then eating, you know, just pouring it into the almost like the dog bowls or something. Then eventually, everything would grow quiet, and he would take a bag out from the back, and he'd a cloth bag, and put it in front of Bob. And then you'd open, Bob describes how you'd open the bag, and inside there would be a wooden box. And then you would open the wooden box, and inside there would be another, a velvet bag. And then there would be a raku cup. And raku cups, if you know, are kind of primitive cups, but fingerprints are sometimes on and so forth. And you would do the tea in that thing. And Bob just talked about, this is before he got to the end of his, what an enormous impact that had. And if, for instance, you go to the Getty Garden, which he, this crazy thing happened where the Getty was losing control of the landscaping because Richard Meyer, this very, very geometric, Aristotelian, Thomistic architect, was just flattening everything. And every landscape architect they threw at him, you know, was immediately demolished. And so they decided that they would bring in Robert Irwin, who had just won the MacArthur. And Irwin, by the way, was one of my 8 MacArthurs. I've had 8 people win MacArthurs within a year of my writing about them. So I will be taking applications. And I keep on saying the MacArthur said, you know, they talk about Zen when I point my finger at the moon, don't mistake my finger for the moon. But anyway, so they threw Irwin at Meyer, and they had an incredible war, which I documented in a piece in the New Yorker called When Fountainheads Collide. But the point that when you talk to him about the things he did in the garden, he everything in the garden was a way of approaching a sequence of diminutions of field and so forth, so you got closer, so that eventually you could see this petal, that stalk. You know, he would have parts that were raised. There are all kinds of things going on in the garden, sounds and so forth. He has the different bridges as you go down the thing, and on either side of each bridge, he has tuned the water. So it's a different sound on both sides and different as you go down and so forth. There's all this kind of stuff, which is, and when I talked to him about, you know, what is the model for what you're doing? He said, it's that tea ceremony. It's that opening up. So I think he's very aware of that. In terms of mathematics, absolutely. I mean, what's funny, what you often get with artists is kind of throwing around uncertainty principle and incompleteness and Gödel and so forth, without really quite understanding what they mean, but they are pointing in a direction. Your comment a second ago about the silence that you would, which is the only proper response to some of these great theories, reminds me of the end of the Tractatus, where Wittgenstein, in his logical positivist mode, in a sense, writes the Tractatus, which is 7 points, a statement, then 1.1, 1.11, 1.12, 1.2, 1.1, and it goes for 80 pages. He wrote it, you know, largely in the trenches in World War I. And the 7th point, which if you think about it, the 7th day, the last point he says, of that which we cannot speak, of that we must be silent. And the logical positivists all read that to say, well, we should therefore not talk about God or mysticism or metaphysics. And it's exactly the opposite, in a way, is what becomes of him after that. He flips around and he spends the rest of his life trying to get to talk about the unsayable, but not directly and so forth. And one of the things I interpret from that is that there are easy silences and there are earned silences. You know, after Auschwitz, there can be no poetry. You know? That's easy to say. But it takes Paul Celan to get all the way there, working it through and so forth. It is, I think, one of the tragedies in some sense that mathematics, as it's taught, lets you know that it's, you are not worthy of understanding this incredibly complicated thing and so forth. And one of my great, I revere mathematicians who can take you as close as you can to that silence. And it is absolutely an aesthetic experience. I mean, that's one of the things they always talk about, the beauty. This must be true because it's so beautiful, which gets them in trouble sometimes.
Yeah, it's justified as a way to balance your checkbook, but mathematics is some of the most sublime art that we've ever.
Yeah, yeah. And Bob would talk to me about some mathematician he'd been talking to, and how it reminded him of a problem that he was having, you know, and so on.
Very good. Thank you so much, friend.
Okay, thank you.